Hey, today we're going to be going over the Sporeguard Juggernaut Moltenstrike character. Now, I seen this build on PoE Ninja, and I decided, let's see what this chest is about, right? I seen this chest getting floating around. It's fairly expensive. I was like, let's see what kind of builds people are making with them. Came across this build. I thought, okay, enemies on fungal ground, you kill, explode, dealing 5% of their life as chaos damage. You have fungal ground, he's standing still, which is what you see around my feet here. Interesting effect. I was like, okay, let's check it out. So I picked it up. I ended up six linking it myself. This chest six linked with these types of rolls is around 8 exalts. So it's not cheap. It's not a cheap option. And in my honest opinion, the only reason I could see this chest being decent is for the anointment option that it gives to you. Other than that, I don't see it being worth it. Now the anointment that I don't have on here, that I didn't put on yet, is right here, which would be Disciple of the Slaughter, which cost about 1 exalt due to the gold oil. That would go on your chest, which, 5% damage per frenzy charge. That gives you +1 minimum frenzy charge, so it's a permanent frenzy charge with your 3, and then chance to gain frenzy charges on kills. So it's a 15% damage increase. Okay. But I haven't tested that yet, so I'm not sure if it's worth or not. But again, 8x being the most expensive piece, still up in the air about it. Now, the next item that we use here is a Devotos with the Molten Strike, fires 2 additional projectiles. Molten Strike, for those that don't know, is a skill that when you attack, it summons a bunch of little balls everywhere and they fall down. They look like little meatballs. In this case, mine have the MTX on it. So what that does is that basically every strike does 2 more balls. Okay. So with that same concept going, just like most Molten Strike builds, you want to get as many balls as possible for 2 reasons. 1, because it's more damage, and 2, because it's more healing, and I'll get to that. Now, so with your helmet running 2 additional projectiles, okay, so now we're at 2 projectiles. We'll use a Growwood Shank. Now, mine's pretty decent because it has a chance to fortify a melee hit, which saves us a gem socket, but obviously, you don't need that, right? That's just a survival bonus. This is like 4x, you don't need it. But here, skills fire additional 2 projectiles if you've been hit recently, right? So now we're at 4, okay, +4. Really, really nice. On top of that, point blank, which means damage, the less they have to move, like the projectiles move, so that's more damage there, which is very nice, saves us a point. And then on top of that, armor, while stationary, this build is based off of a shit ton of armor. So this weapon is overall perfect for the build, okay? So now we have 4 projectiles coming from our gear. We also run Wildfire Drill. Okay, now what this says is with at least 40 strength and radius, Molten Strike fires 2 additional projectiles. So now we're at 6. 6 extra balls per attack. Now the reason this gets interesting is because of a lovely little gem called Ancestral Call. Now what this does is it says supported strike skills target 2 additional nearby enemies. So that essentially you get your attack and then say enemy over here and enemy over here also get attacked. So that's 3 attacks in 1 swing. Okay. So now with our 6 extra balls, each one of those attacks is getting 6 extra balls. Right. So now we're at 18 balls extra, just added. There you go. So you can see how juicy +2 really is. So now the reason this gets even greater is because on top of the Ancestral Call being 18 balls now, right, because of the extra attacks from the extra 6 that we got from our gear, now we go to our anointment for Zoth's Blood, Tribal Fury. What does that do? Let's go down here and read this. Strike skills target an additional nearby enemy. So now we attack 3 nearby enemies plus our original attack. So now you add another 6 balls to that for 18. So now we're at 24 extra balls raining from the heavens above, doing damage to everybody else. Now on top of all that extra damage, because the way Molten Strikes works is it's basically damage per ball, that's also massive amounts of survivability. And the reason in this case is because we run Vitality. Now what's great about Vitality by itself is, it's just life regen. Why does that give us survivability? Well, you run a Watcher's Eye that has life gained for each enemy hit while affected by vitality. So now, those extra 24 balls you just added to your skill, plus the balls that the skill naturally has, plus the 3 extra mobs getting attacked. So as you can see, there's a lot of balls on the screen going crazy. That's 30 life gained per ball, per enemy hit. If you are attacking, unless you are literally one shot, it is very hard to kill you. Which makes a build like this very good for delving, or essentially survivable in a lot of situations, which I showcase a Minotaur here in a little bit, where I do die because I tried to tank as much as I could. But you'll see, with my lack of gear, in a sense of like gem levels and whatnot, I just stood there. Just stood there. Which is where something like this is great. Now, ascendancy-wise, we are Juggernaut. I did not do my Uber Lab yet, because the idea of these builds is to go on PeeWee Trade, pick up the gear, throw some gems in it, and go, right? So I tried to make it as a little bit higher than middle point, but not min-maxed. So we take Undeniable for accuracy and crit. We take Unflinching for endurance charge gain when you're hit, which I'll get into that. And then that's a +1, which is very important. And then Unrelenting, physical damage reduction per endurance charges. Again, stacking endurance charges, typical Juggernaut type build. You're running a Combs Way for a +1 endurance charge. You're taking your endurance charges in your tree, okay? As you see here. So currently I have 8 endurance charges. Now, I have no res. When you shout, or basically get hit, or mainly shout, that's why we run Enduring Cry. The second you hit that, you're at 8 endurance charges, you are now res capped, because endurance charges give you resistances and physical damage reduction and all that good juicy stuff. On top of that, like I said, this is an armor based build. So as you can see here, just standing here, I have 15,000 armor. 15,000 armor. That's not to mention, you know, Val Molten Shells, adding all that additional armor, 1,000 armor, like 800 armor, 1,000 armor, etc. and all that. All the endurance charge armor, etc. So we're pretty tanky. We're pretty tanky. I'm only level 84. I only have 4,700 life. Essentially, you'd have around 6k life at 90 if you actually branched up and took the life nodes and whatnot, which I didn't get to that yet. So... oh, and our granite flask, which is 3,000 armor. So you get the gist of the build. Now, I did go a little bit of expensive on this one, due to you don't need the fortify melee hit. I paid extra for that. The devotees with the enchant is about 1 exalt. Zoff's blood is like a 2 exalt amulet. Last time I checked, and then the tribal fury allocation is about 1.5 exalt. So we'll say 3 exalts for this. The Sporeguard, like I said, my personal opinion is not needed, but this is 8x 6 linked. And what else? Your money could go sunk into a weapon. This weapon I just picked up really, really cheap. I think it was like less than 60c, but it's basically 470 physical, or 470 total DPS, like 280 physical, or sorry, 190 physical and 280 elemental. Personally, just high physical, attack speed, crit type claw. Which I'll go into why we're using Claw in a second. And then, yeah, everything else is fairly cheap. You know, nothing really expensive. Like, you could go more expensive. Like, finding a decent Stygian Vice with Aspect of the Spider, because we do run Aspect of Spider in this build, could be a little difficult. Maybe this could run you a pretty penny, maybe an Exalt or whatever. But everything else is fairly cheap. Now, one of the interesting things about this build is the fact that we're using 3 different anointments, right? We have Tribal Fury, as I explained, is the additional attack. We have Sporeguard, which I already explained would be Disciple of the Slaughter. And then we have Breath Stealer Gloves, right? Which allocates Soul Raker. Now, for those that don't know Soul Rakers, it's way over here. Increased damage with claws. Attack damage leeched his life. Attack damage leeched his mana. Total recovery speed during life leech, which is great, so it's even more life regen back, and increased damage with ailments while wielding a claw. That's why we use a claw. Okay, so, and it's a free another anointment, and it's super, super cheap for what it gives. Very cheap. Now, the other thing that's interesting about these gloves is create a blighted spore when your skills or minions kill a rare monster. Now, I was trying to figure out what this meant until I randomly killed something and I seen this little pus ball. And the best way I could explain it is it kind of looks like the helmet that you get for the challenge rewards on Blight League. So, basically what it is it you stand next to it and it sends out an aura of a buffed buff. It's the best way to explain it. So, like, if it's attack speed, say normal attack speed is like 15%, this thing's giving you like 35%, right? So, it's almost like a standstill headhunter, but very small radius. As soon as you move out, it you don't have that buff, right? It doesn't stick with you. It just stays in where you killed the rare monster. It's an interesting little quirk. These gloves I could see being used outside of this build. Again, the chest piece, maybe I'm missing something, but the extra exploding doesn't really add to clear. Maybe for Blade Flurry or something it might, but for Moltenstrike it doesn't really. And it's probably there strictly as just the extra contaminant is basically, I believe what it is you get, where is it out of here? Oh, while you're on the fungal ground, when you're standing still, you gain 10% of non-chaos damage, extra chaos damage, right? So basically, you get extra chaos damage of 10% of your damage, which, yeah, is nice. And then enemies on fungal ground deal 10% less damage, so less damage taken for you. So, yeah, I guess overall, that's not bad. But in the upcoming part here, I'm going to showcase the builds. I'm going to showcase the build going through the different tiers of maps. Again, to really go into it, the way I do this is basically if you were to go on PoE Trade or pathofexile.com/trade and pick up some pieces, throw some gems in. My gems are level 18, 17, fairly low gems, no quality on them at all. My weapon's fairly cheap. I did go a little bit expensive on some things, but again, this chest piece, honestly, you could probably do without even a 5-link of something other than that. There is some mandatories, like I would say Zoss Blood's pretty mandatory. Definitely go for, you know, a Growwood doesn't need to have the fortify melee hit. Enchant Devotos is obviously, again, more projectiles the better. And then definitely your Watcher's Eye. And the best thing about this Watcher's Eye is life gain for enemy hit with vitality is around 100 chaos. So it's not expensive at all. So that being said, enjoy the map showcase, and we will get to our ranking system at the end of the maps. Enjoy. All right, there it was. And this is how we'll be judging the builds based off of my opinion and whatnot. We'll be going over speed of clear, gear value versus content cleared, overall performance of the build, and a personal fun factor. Now, with speed of clear, I would give this a 4 out of 5. Reason being is because you could basically one tap and go. Now, granted, this may be because of the Sporeguard, but still adds a decent amount of speed. Big packs just melt. Gear value versus content. I'm going to give this a 3 out of 5. The reason being is because some of the gear is a little bit on the expensive end. If we decide that Sporeguard is needed, then obviously that's a big chunk of money that you'll need to drop. You'll have to do your own testing to see if Sporeguard is worth it to you or not. So at that case, because of the value of that, I'm going to put that at a 3. Other than that, I do feel like you could just slap on any other chest. You don't need the corruptions I have and just go. So I'm going to put that in the middle point of 3 out of 5. Overall performance, I'm going to give this build a 4 out of 5. The reason being is because you're able to do a lot of content with very minimal effort. Again, I said I'm not good at bossing and whatnot, and half the time you could just stand there. Just as long as you're attacking, you just live forever. The build for the pieces that are required outside of the Sporeguard chest are fairly cheap if you're playing the game a decent amount, and the main survivability aspect of it is very cheap, which is the Vitality Watcher's Eye. So definitely 4 out of 5 on overall performance. And a personal fun factor, I'm going to give this a 3 out of 5. And the reason being is because it honestly just plays just like every single Moltenstrike build out there. You know, whirling blades through, hit your Moltenstrike, and then bosses, you just stand there leeching off of your multiple balls. So that brings us to an overall score of 14 out of 20. I highly recommend this build. I think for it's what it's worth playing, especially if you've never played something tanky, or something that didn't require too much effort in the sense of player skill to down content, especially, within maybe completing your Atlas or doing Shaper for the first time. And on that note, I will leave the POB down below of the full build, and of course any questions you could just leave in the comment questions section below. There was no build guide for this, as I said, I found it off of PoE Ninja. Otherwise I would link to the creator's build guide. If somebody finds something that's similar to this that we could link together with this, then I will gladly give that person a shout out. So again, and thank you so much. Hopefully you enjoyed this one, and we'll see you in the next one. If you have something you want to suggest for me to try, by all means, leave it down below. Thanks, guys.